all he's doing in Nicaragua. So again, like I said, my name is Pastor Trevor. Thank y'all for coming here tonight to worship with us, to hear from the Lord tonight. We're fast approaching Thanksgiving. So we want to look at all types of reasons why we can be thankful during this holiday season. And the main thing that we can be thankful for is to remember all that God has done for us. Amen. So we're going to be in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. So you go ahead and turn your Bibles there. We're going to get to that scripture in a moment. But first, I want to point out that this week, many of us will focus on all the reasons that we have to be thankful. Who knows, we have all kinds of reasons to be thankful. I was just sharing how we're going to be partaking in some really awesome food on Thursday. How many people are going to be partaking in some turkey and some mashed potatoes and some baked macaroni and some cornbread dressing and all that good stuff? Don't forget about the pumpkin pie, the sweet potato pie. I mean, we have a whole lot of reasons to be thankful just for food that's coming on Thursday. That's my most exciting. Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday. It really is. Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday. And who knows that we can be thankful because our Saints fans have a reason to rejoice in how awesome our Saints are doing, huh? Man, they're probably going to go to play. They might even win the Super Bowl. Shut your mouth. I'm telling you. Listen, it reminds me of a story. Look, just the other week, they had a report come from the Atlanta Falcons practice field. They had a postponed practice. And why did they have to postpone practice? Because a couple of the players, they found some unknown white powdery substance on that field. So they had to call in the authority. The practice was postponed. The authority showed up, and they were able to identify that white powdery substance. It came to no shock to them that the Atlanta Falcons players had no idea what it was. Do you know what it was? The goal line. Right. Hey, so that's another reason why we can be thankful. We can be thankful that we're not Atlanta Falcons fans. Amen?
Amen.
Hey, listen, if you are Atlanta Falcons fans, just see me after it and we'll lead you to repentance. In Jesus' name. Anyway, so we have all kinds of reasons to be thankful. Tim Keller says like this, we have a lot to be thankful for, but we must remember that it's one thing to be grateful and it's another thing to give thanks. Gratitude is what you feel. Thanksgiving is what you do. You see, as Christians, we should celebrate more than just one day of Thanksgiving. Our lives should exude gratitude. We should be a people, a culture that are Thanksgiving. Everything, each and every day, we should live lives of Thanksgivings. And one of the best ways to live a life of Thanksgiving is by remembering all that God has done for us.
Amen.
Amen. Apostle Paul says it like this in our scripture, Philippians 4, 6. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done.
Amen.
Do you know the Apostle Paul was writing this scripture while he was in jail? He was in jail when he wrote this scripture, and he had an attitude of gratitude because he remembered all that God has done in his life and that his eternity was assured to him, that he would spend forever with Jesus. You see, we can be thankful that God has our back as believers. Amen. So we remember all that he's done. But so many times as a culture, we tend to forget about what God has done,
right?
We start complaining, or we start worrying, or having anxiety. Do you know complaining and worrying is the opposite of being thankful?
Yeah.
So if we catch ourselves complaining, we need to be like, you know what? I need to remember all God has done.
Yes.
I don't need to be complaining because God has done a whole lot of things.
Yep.
So we have a culture where we've forgotten all that God has done. But listen, it's not something strange that's happening. They talk about it all in scripture. I mean, even Adam and Eve, guys. Adam and Eve were given paradise. They were given paradise. You can eat of anything, any tree here, except that one. They forgot about all God had done, about all that land that God has given them, about giving them charge over the animals, about creating them. He created them from the dust. I mean, you forgot about what God did? And you disobeyed him by going to the tree? Not only Adam and Eve, but think about the Israelites in Exodus. I mean, the Lord used Moses to bring the Israelites out of Egypt, where they were being tortured and meant to work all day long, slaving. It was slave to the Israelites. He brought him out of Egypt. He parted the Red Sea for him. He rained down manna from heaven. He made water come out of a rock. But they forgot God and became ungrateful. So it's not uncommon that us as a people today forget all God has done and forget to be thankful for what he has done. In Exodus, it says, when the people saw how long it was taking Moses to come back there on the mountain, they gathered around Aaron. Come on, they said, make us some gods who can lead us. We don't know what happened to this fellow Moses. I guess they just forgot that he raised his staff and parted the Red Sea, and they escaped from the Egyptians trying to capture him. We got to remember to be thankful. In Psalm 78:7, the psalmist writes, so each generation should set its hope anew in God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. We must be a generation, we must be a culture that never forgets what God has done. You see, when we remember what God has done and continue to do for us, our hearts and lives are filled with thanksgiving. We need to remember all that God has done. I want to tell you a survey. There was a survey and an article done by the Huffington Post entitled The Neuroscience of Why Gratitude Makes Us Healthier. Yes. Do you know being negative affects your health?
Oh, yes.
You have less energy. You're more prone to divorce and broken homes. However, people who have a life of thanksgiving have more energy throughout the day. They exercise more often. They spend more time with their children. They even have healthier marriages. People who are prone to positivity and being thankful and having an attitude of gratitude tend to be more healthy. You see, so being thankful affects more than just our spirit man. It affects our physical man as well. So we better get this thing right. Look, this Thanksgiving, we have a lot to be thankful for, but let us not forget that every day, 365 days a year, we need to have an attitude of gratitude. Our lives need to exude thanksgiving. So let us ask ourselves one question. What are some of the many things that God has done that should fill our hearts and lives with thanksgiving? So today, I want to cover five basic truths, but very powerful truths. The first truth I want to share with y'all, we should be filled with thanksgiving because God has saved our lives.
Amen.
God saves our lives. Ephesians 2:8 says, God saved you by his grace when you believe. Just think about that verse for a moment. You didn't have to do anything except believe. The moment that you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died for your sin, you believe that he rose again so that he can live in you, you were saved. That means an eternity in heaven, an eternity in paradise. What could this world do to you when you're promised heaven? Amen. Amen? Do you know that the eternity in heaven is going to be so much more than your life here on earth?
Amen. That's right.
Wow. He saves our lives. Next weekend, we'll be starting our Christmas series entitled The King to Come. We're going to be looking at some of the Old Testament prophecies that were told of our coming King, Jesus Christ. What an amazing prophecies that show that God knew all along that he was going to send Jesus, his only son, to earth to save us. But we need to remember this. Jesus wasn't plan B.
No.
Jesus was a plan A. God always knew that he would have to take the form of a man, right, to come down to earth so we can identify with a man to bring us to salvation.
Right.
It reminded me of a pastor. There was a pastor, a young kid went to his pastor. Pastor, I don't really understand this thing about salvation, how God turned into a man, and how, can you explain that to me? And the pastor's like, okay, so let me explain this to you. There was this family of four, right? Mom, husband, and the two kids. And every weekend, the mom would go to church. It was a stormy day. It was snowing outside. And just like every week, the wife would invite the husband to church. And she was like, husband, you know, you want to come to church today? And he's like, you know, I don't believe in that God stuff. That doesn't make any sense to me. How can Jesus be somebody who saves us? How can a God just turn into a man and come and die for us? That doesn't make any sense. I don't believe in all that God stuff. So then immediately the woman was like, no, I ain't going to fight with them. she took her kids and they went to church. Later on that evening, the man was at his TV watching some TV, snowstorm going outside, all of a sudden he hears a big thump. What happened? He looked out the window, this goose had flew into his window. So he looked outside to see what was going on. It was a flock of geese that was struggling to get out of this snowstorm. So he's like, man, what can I do to save him? So he's like, all right. So he went out there, he opened up his barn door where it was warm to try to get his geese to go into the barn so they can be warm and get out the snow, but they didn't go. So he ran back inside trying to think, man, what can I do? He says, I got an idea. He took some bread. Man, he broke up some bread. He went outside and he put a trail of bread to the open barn door, thinking that's gonna get them. They're gonna go into the barn door with this trail of bread. He goes inside, looks at the window, but they frantically going back and forth, and no, they didn't go, they didn't receive what he tried to do. So he's like, man, what can I do? So he said, I'm gonna try one more thing. He went outside and he took the geese, he tried to pull the geese and throw them in there, but they were slapping at him. He couldn't get them to go in the barn for nothing. So he went back inside, he's like, man, what am I gonna do? He thought to himself and he chuckled for a second. He's like, I know what I can do. I can become like one of those geese and I can fly in there and they'll follow me in there. And he thought for a second, he dropped to his knees and he realized that was God's heart to mankind, that he had to come as one of us to lead us to salvation.
Amen. Amen.
That's salvation, guys. That's the love that God has for us, that he would not even spare his one and only son. You see, Jesus came in the form of the man to show us the way to the Father, to show us the way home, to save us. You see, we must never lose our awe and appreciation for all that God has done to save us. In 1 Peter 2, it says it like this: He, Jesus, personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. Jesus did it all. He took my place. He took your place. Aren't you thankful for that today?
Amen.
Aren't you thankful that the Lord would not stop at nothing? He was so relentless in his love for us that he came in the form of a man, lived a perfect life, was mocked, was spit on, was bruised, never sinned, and died for each and every one of us. And you may be in here today, you may be like, I can't really be thankful for that because I don't know if I've actually done that. I don't know if I've actually come to a place where I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. So I want to give you an opportunity to do that today. If everyone in here would just bow their heads and close their eyes, if there's never been a time in your life where you've entered into that relationship with God, where you've taken that help that God gave to us to show us all way home for eternity, a life in paradise forever with Jesus, you can have an opportunity to do that today. The Bible says that if you would believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is who he says he is, the Son of God, the Savior of the world, who died for your sins to bring you into relationship with him, if you believe that he rose from the dead 3 days later, you can repeat this prayer after me, and the Bible says you can be saved and be guaranteed an eternity in heaven. You can say, Dear Lord Jesus, I recognize that I'm a sinner and I'm in need of a Savior. Show me the way home, God. Come into my life. I want to follow you, Lord. I believe you are who you say you are. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. Jesus, I believe you're the Savior of the world. I confess you as my Lord and that I want to follow you for the rest of my days. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Listen, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, please indicate that in the communication card to where we can be praying for you. But listen, who's thankful that God saves our lives? Amen. What an awesome thing to be thankful for. When we realize that truth, there's nothing that can happen in this world that can steal our Thanksgiving. Amen. So next, we need to be thankful that he saves our lives. But secondly, we should be filled with Thanksgiving because God seals our lives. He seals Amen. Our lives. In Ephesians 1:13, the Apostle Paul writes, when you believe, you are marked with him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Amen. We can be thankful because God did not leave us alone here on earth, but he sealed us at the moment that we accepted him with his precious spirit. The precious spirit of the living God dwells in everyone that believes. This is a reason to be thankful. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We should be thankful for the Holy Spirit because of several reasons. One, we can be special. We can be thankful for the Holy Spirit because he reminds us of Jesus' teaching. You ever been going through something in life, a circumstance in life, and then the Holy Spirit reminds you of scripture to make you feel better? We need to be thankful because he reminds us of his teachings. Next, we should also be thankful for the Holy Spirit because he convicts us of our sins.
Amen.
I got some amen for that. Amen. Right, but who knows, like at first, conviction, I'm really saying, right? It's kind of like when you're a kid and your daddy and your mama, they discipline you, right? They give you a little nudge or they give you some, they make you punish. Or they, hey, today, in today's generation, you know what the best punishment is? You take away that phone. Boy, you take away that phone, shoot. Listen, this is the kind of conviction I'm talking about. Listen, we need to be thankful when God convicts us, when the Holy Spirit convicts us over our wrongdoings, over our misleadings, over our attitudes, over our actions, right? Thirdly, we should be thankful for the Holy Spirit because he guides us towards all truth. When we're reading the Bible, we need to know that when we give our life to God, that Holy Spirit inside us will guide us in all truth within that word. When we read that word, we need to be confident that we know what's going on.
Amen.
Amen? That's a promise of the Holy Spirit, that he guides us to all truth. Nextly, we have to be also thankful for the Holy Spirit because he always glorifies Jesus. Charles Spurgeon says it like this: without the Spirit of God, we can do nothing. We are ships without wind, chariots without steeds, like branches without sap. We are withered like coals without fire. We need the Holy Spirit, and if we save, we have him, and that should fill us with thanksgiving. He gives us the power that we need here on earth to live a life of victory, and that should give us thanksgiving. Amen?
Amen?
That should make us thankful. So next, we should also be thankful because God sanctifies our lives. God sanctifies our lives. Philippians 1:6, Paul says it like this: and I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished. Amen. You see, after salvation, sanctification is the daily, lifelong process of becoming more and more like Jesus.
That's right.
Now, I want to tell y'all a little story about me. Can I be honest with you guys? I'm going to be really honest. So I gave my life to Jesus Christ in 2010, okay? I went through this program, got out about 9 months. I'm living life. I'm on fire for God. I'm telling everybody about Jesus. I can't help myself. I've got this newfound love for Jesus, this love I've never experienced before. I wanted to tell everybody. Everybody needed to know. But can I tell you what? That I didn't always get it right.
That's right.
I didn't always get it right. I'm on fire for God, telling God about, telling people about the Lord, loving Jesus, going to church, doing all these things. But then, you know, I had this girlfriend. His girlfriend that I was with before I came to the Lord. And we wasn't married. And then we went out one night, and then we did some things that we shouldn't have done that night. Now, at the end of that night, the Holy Spirit convicted me.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit convicted me. And everything in my mind was telling me, ignore that. You're only a man. You have manly desires. You have manly needs. I didn't listen to that voice. Instead, I listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit that tells me that you need to wait to be married before you can do that with another woman.
Amen.
And in that moment, the Holy Spirit gave me courage not only to repent to God, but to make amends with that girl.
That's right.
Now, I wish I could tell you that was the last time I'm going to walk with the Lord, but about 8 months later, it happened again. And thanks be to God, for the grace of God, I was able to respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit again. Understand? You see, the sanctification process happens when we respond rightly to the convictions of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
You understand? Whenever, it's not us. It's not us. It's God leading the way for us.
That's right.
Right? It's kind of like God reaching down and showing us the way into that barn, right? For the warmth and for that tranquility, right? We need to listen to that conviction and not ignore it, because God's a gentleman. He's going to let you know. Sooner or later, that voice might get a little dimmer and a little dimmer.
Yep.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
We need to listen.
to that conviction and not ignore it.
And
when we don't ignore it, when we allow the sanctification process to happen in our lives, wow. You want your prayers to be answered? You want your family to be saved? You want your community transformed by the power of God? You better listen to the Holy Spirit. You listen to him when he convicts you. All right, Jesus, I'm sorry. I'm not going to do that again. I need your power. I don't want to do that. I want to do what you want me to do because I love you, God. I fall short. Help me, Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Do y'all feel that?
Amen.
It's not nothing special we do except say, okay, God.
Yep.
Amen? Because you're not going to always get it right. I didn't get it right. You're not going to always get it right. But guess what? When you hear that from the Holy Spirit, you feel that conviction, you respond to that conviction, and you move on with, and lean on Jesus to help you not do that again. Amen? We need to be thankful for that. We need to be thankful that the Holy Spirit convicts us and sanctifies our lives. This is an awesome thing because as the sanctification process matures and matures and matures, we become more and more and more like Jesus to be able to have a greater impact in our family, in our community, and in our world. Amen?
Amen.
One of the primary evidence of a growing Christian is thankfulness.
Yes.
Colossians 2 says it like this, let your roots grow down into him and let your lives be built on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth that you were taught and you will overflow with thankfulness. A growing Christian is thankful Christian because a thankful Christian knows that they depend on God for everything. It's okay to depend on God for everything because guess what? I'd rather depend on the God of the universe, the creator of all things, rather than depending on my own self.
Amen.
Amen. So we need to be thankful. We need to be thankful that God sanctifies. And next, we should be filled with thanksgiving because God supplies our needs.
Yes.
In Philippians 4:19, the Apostle Paul writes, and the same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glory of riches which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. We should be thankful because God knows our needs. Sometimes we're not thankful because God doesn't supply all of our wants. Amen? The scripture doesn't say he's going to supply all your wants. He's going to supply all your needs. And know this, that God is such a good father. He knows exactly what we need. Who knows that sometimes our kids, when they're young, they don't really know what they need. They think they know what they need. But they don't really know what they need.
Right.
Kind of same things with us and God. He knows exactly what we need.
Yes.
So whatever you have, you need to be thankful for that because that was given to you and blessed upon you by God. So we should be thankful for that.
Amen.
He supplies all our needs. We should be thankful also because God cares about our needs. In 1 Peter 5:7, he says, God cares about you. He cares about those longings in your heart. He cares about those desires. And listen, those desires and those prayers might be in the will of the Father. Don't think that his delays are denials.
That's right.
Sometimes you just he's doing something within you to prepare you for that prayer you've been praying for that blessing that he's fixing to unload on you. Don't get weary in well-doing. Continue to do good and know that he hears you. Know that he cares for your needs. Know that he cares about these prayers more than even you care about these prayers when they align in the center of his will, right?
He's
praying for these addictions to get broken, for this crime to stop, or for a family member to get saved. He hears you. He knows about it, and he cares about that. We need to be thankful that God supplies all our needs. And lastly, we need to be thankful because God strengthens our lives.
Yes.
God strengthens our lives. In Philippians 4:11-13, the word says, I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live in almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength.
Amen.
Amen.
You see, God strengthens our lives as we grow in our understanding of our dependence upon him. The psalmist writes in Psalm 54:4, surely God is my help. The Lord is the one who sustains me. You see, that word sustain means to support, strengthen, nourish, carry, to keep alive. We need to know that our strength comes from God, and that we are totally, utterly, 100% dependent upon God. You see, in all brokenness, when we realize we're nothing without God, we find His strength. And that's why the Apostle Paul says, I boast more in my weaknesses, because when I boast in my weaknesses, His strength, His power is made perfect within me. It's in our weakness, in our utter dependence upon God, that we find His strength. The psalmist writes in Psalm 68, 19, praise the Lord, the God our Savior, for each day He carries us in His arms. We should be thankful for all the moments God has brought to us and brought us through. See, God strengthens our lives, and it's a reason to be thankful. You know, whatever circumstances that you're going through right now, you have a reason to be thankful. You can find that strength when you get to a place where you put that in the hands of God and depend on Him fully, and He'll give you the strength to pull through that situation. Amen. That's a promise from God when you depend upon Him. There's a testimony by one of our pastors. He's a pastor of our Iglesia Celebration, our Spanish-speaking church in Mary. So I just want to share this testimony, how a woman found thankfulness in a dire situation. If you would, direct your attention to the screen behind me.
I actually remember exactly where I was when I saw someone live out what it means to give thanks in all circumstances. It was 2007. I was living in Mexico, serving in a local church. And when I lived in Mexico, I stayed with an elderly lady at the church. Her name was Chelito. One evening, I was out playing soccer with some of the youth, and I got a phone call from one of our neighbors. He said, you need to run home quick. Chelo has been in an accident. A truck hit the taxi that she was coming home in. They didn't bring her to the hospital. She didn't have money for the hospital, so they just dropped her off at home. So I ran home, and I ran in. I ran upstairs. I couldn't find her. I ran downstairs. She was on the couch, bloodied face, bruised. So I didn't know what to do, so I ran up and got her niece, and her niece came down, and I'm thinking that we need to go immediately to the hospital, and Chelito turns over and she says, we can go to the hospital, but first we're gonna pray. And I'm like, how are we gonna pray? We can pray on the way, let's just go. You know, and she says, no, I want everybody to hold hands. And by this time, people from church had gotten there, and her niece, and I'm standing there, and we're holding hands, and we're praying. And then when we finished praying, Chelito said, I'll go to the hospital, but I'll go in the morning. And I'm like, you can't do that. You can't go in the morning. Like, you need to go now. You could have a concussion. You shouldn't go to sleep. I'm thinking all these things. And in the morning, when I woke up, I was awoken by the sound of someone singing. And it was Chelito downstairs. Her head is all wrapped up, still bruised, but she was cooking. And I was like, Chelito, how can you be doing this? And that evening, it was a Wednesday. I was at church, and people were asking me, where's Chelito? How is she? How's she doing? I said, she's fine. I'm sure she's gonna stay home tonight. She's resting. And I remember exactly what happened in this moment. I'm standing there looking at the stage. We're singing praise to the Lord. And I see the people in front of me start looking behind. And they're looking back. And so when I turn around and look back, what do I see? But little old Chelito coming up the stairs, walking into church. And people are trying to talk to her and ask her if she's okay. And she's pushing them off. And I see this little old lady moved to the seat where she always would sit. She moved the chair out of the way, got on her knees, raised her hands, and started praising God. And in that moment, I knew what it looked like to give thanks to God in all circumstances.
I give a round of applause to God.